And we have distinguished speakers, Professor Ada Yonath over there. Oh, very popular. Professor Robert Huber. Professor Harold Zuhausen. Professor Yuan Chet Lee. Professor Hitoshi Murayama. And Professor Vladimir Vavovsky. I think our plan would be kind of to talk about, to have two rounds of discussion, at least one main round, about 5 minutes each for each speaker. And then after the first session, we will ask the students to ask questions. And then after a while, we can continue, have a second session, either continuing on the previous topic. Each person can continue on the previous topic or choose a new topic to talk about or discuss what has been said by other speakers. And then we end up with some more questions from the students, okay? So how science can help us understand life and improve our future? I always think that if we think of the future, we must begin with the past, and we must understand the present. So perhaps we'll start off along the lines of the universe and life. And may I ask Professor Murayama to begin talking about the universe or something like that? Universe and life or whatever.
Okay, I have to say I don't have a really prepared remark, but let me just get started anyway. So I was giving five possible topics under this big headline of the universe and life. The universe is written in the language of mathematics. How did life originate on Earth? Other planets in the universe with like right conditions for life. If there are other thinking beings in the universe, should we try to contact them and how? And cloning and genetic manipulation in humans, what can we do and should we do it? Now, beginning with this, the connection to the mathematics, which is something I'm still very surprised at. The physical sciences have succeeded so well are using the language of mathematics, but mathematics, I would say the proofs of mathematics is not natural sciences at all. You're trying to build up a new framework on your own, and so it's actually surprising, and even Wigner said that explicitly, inexplicable usefulness of mathematics and natural sciences. So why does the universe care about mathematics, which is actually creation of our own brain? And there's something apparently very universal about mathematics, which transcends the human beings in some way, and I don't exactly know what that is. But I certainly still believe that the mathematics is the right language to describe the universe and natural world in some way. And so continuing on advances both on the side of mathematics and physical sciences actually are feeding each other in the development, and I very much hope that would continue on. And as a matter of fact, when I gave this speech at the United Nations, the way I conclude this remark is something like this. So I made sure that the institute I founded in Japan, Institute for the Physics and Mathematics of the Universe, is open to anybody irrespective of their origins. I specifically named it as the Institute of the Universe because anybody from other planets can apply to jobs. And which I believe, still the same physical laws should apply to the entire universe, which I have to say is only belief. It's very difficult to prove that, but nonetheless, that's the basic hypothesis. And also another belief is that the physical laws are supposed to be simple and beautiful. Again, there's no guarantee, but somehow this very simple concept has been extremely successful, and we just hope that it will continue to be that way. And having said that, the conditions for life in other planets may be, of course, very different. Other life forms may be living in liquid ammonia or something, so they may take a very different shapes. They may not be able to communicate in the way we do, but from what I learned from chemistry, biochemistry, the carbon is probably the basic ingredient for life to be able to construct very complex molecules, like protein. the genetic code we have in the life forms and the life Earth seems to be also very capable, and people don't see any alternatives. So it could still be the case that life forms in other planets may ultimately be based on the same language or genetic code in some way. I'm very curious to know, to hear more about it from other members on the panel. And so I do believe that there are other life forms on other, elsewhere in the universe. I don't know if they're intelligent to be able to communicate with us, but nonetheless, I certainly believe that we should try to listen to them. Contacting them is very difficult, because if you send a signal, it will take probably tens of thousands of years to reach them, so we wouldn't be around to hear back their response. But if they are actually transmitting something, we may be able to listen to them, so that's something we should keep trying. And I'd like to also mention just one thing about this one last theme of one interconnected world to share. I really find it wonderful that the people from 30 countries represented here at the Asian Science Camp, and I said this already, but let me say it again, this is really the first step to achieve peace in the world. People should talk to each other, understand each other. I had no idea that each day in the week in Thailand had different colors, for instance. So that kind of thing is the first step. And so I'm very happy to see that you guys are talking to each other, and that's a really wonderful thing. And you should bring back your experience to your home countries and really spread out this idea that people really can talk to each other. That's actually not obvious to most people in the world, I have to say. So that's what I have to say.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Murayama. So we already left a record for others to find, right? But they won't find it for another 10,000 years. But maybe if they were people that were more advanced than us, they sent a signal 10,000 years ago, we might receive it soon. Anyway, so let's go continue on the mathematics theme. And perhaps Professor Bobovsky would talk about mathematics in the universe or whatever.
Hello. So I'm also going to speak about this topic of universe and life, and so there is something which kind of suddenly became important to me when I was reading through the various questions which were suggested for the panel. And this was a little unexpected to me, but when I read the first topic for this universe and life theme, which is the universe is written in the language of mathematics, Galileo, I decided to check it out. Did he actually say it? And so, thanks for the internet. I went to Google, and after some little search, it required some little effort, I did find the complete sentence which he said. And he didn't say that, of course. And I mean, he wouldn't, obviously. What he said is that in the grand, I'm giving a very short version of the sentence, which also doesn't reflect the complete meaning of it, but it's a little closer. He said that in the grand book of the universe, in the grand book, which is universe, philosophy is written in the language of mathematics. So there are many other things maybe in that grand book of universe which are written in maybe different languages, but this particular thing, philosophy, is written in the grand book of universe in the language of mathematics. That's what he said. So that's one little example. Now, I'm going to speak a little bit more about it later, but that's, I think that connects to the second topic, which is how to make what we as scientists can do, or can do on the everyday basis to make our world to be more together. And one thing we can do is to is to make sure that that there is as much truth and as little untruth in the world as possible. So that we remember our history, that we remember it right, that we don't abuse the things which were said by others. And I'm going to give another example later on in the second half. And that we respect and preserve and do the honor of precision to our memory of the past. Now about much lighter things. So how did the life on Earth originate and from which molecules? My feeling is, I mean, when I look at something like ribosome, right? or even something much simpler than a ribosome, but any kind of this machinery of the cell, I have very strong feeling that that we should consider a hypothesis, a possibility, that the life on Earth is not the first generation life. That since our Earth is relatively, and our Sun is a relatively young star, and our Earth is a relatively young, I mean, our solar system is a relatively young solar system, that the life which we have on Earth is actually a creation of a life of a previous generation, which might have been very, very different in structure and much more likely to appear through the process akin to natural selection than what we see in our world. So basically, it's kind of a scientific way of saying that we should consider a possibility that our life here has been created by some kind of aliens which existed billions of years before we appeared. So that is to the second and to the third. And actually, these aliens might have lived on, of course, on very different kind of planets and might have been, I mean, they may still be living in some sense. They can be very different kind of life, if it can be called life. Should we contact other beings of our type or not? I would personally say that at this point we should sit quiet and try to learn to listen. And only if we hear something and if we understand what we're hearing, then we should think about whether or not we want to make ourselves known. Because I think that's a more reasonable approach. And the fifth question about the genetic manipulation of humans, that I have nothing to say.
You don't want to say. Okay. Well, thank you very much, Vladimir, for your views. And obviously, you are the next person referred to, Ada, the ribosome. And perhaps you'd say, give your ideas about how life originated on Earth.
Good morning. Although I'm talking right after Vladimir, who talked about the creation of universe, I will talk only about materials and ourselves. So in contrast to Vladimir, I looked at the ribosome. Seriously and deeply, and I think that we found, not only me, but our group, found hints of how life originated. I'm not talking about how the universe originated, and maybe something came from somewhere else. This is very easy not to answer. What I'm trying to answer is how life originated. So the ribosome, for I'm sure all you know, it is the machinery, the cellular machinery, that translates the genetic code into proteins. Proteins are the workers of the cells. They are doing almost everything. Almost everything. They are making new materials, new molecules. They are making membranes. They are digesting the food. They are working as the regulators, but they don't make themselves. The chemistry of making a peptide bond, the bond that connects the beads in the proteins. Proteins are long, long, long chains of many, many beads that are called amino acids. The chemistry of binding amino acid one to another is very simple. Proteins could have done it, but they don't. In no cell, in no way, in nature, proteins don't make proteins. The part of the ribosome that makes the protein is the component, that the main component of the ribosome, which is RNA, ribosomal RNA. Only this part is making proteins. Also, this part is doing the decoding. So we looked into this so-called, in the beginning, it was unacceptable and not predictable, that part of the ribosome, 2.5 million molecular weight in bacteria and 4 million in human, the part that makes the protein is RNA. Not only this, we looked into it very carefully and we found that the region, which is about only 3% of the whole ribosome, that makes the protein is fully conserved in all, every living organisms, from bacteria to cockroaches, to fish, to shrimps, to elephants, to the old mammoths and dinosaurs, to us. Every piece of this part of the ribosome, I'll tell you the name in a minute, is fully conserved, fully 99.9 conserved. We looked at 930 sequences. And this part, we thought, this shows that this part is not influenced by evolution, and therefore maybe it was before the ribosome, and we call it the proto-ribosome. And we think, for your information, we think that life started before there were cells, before there were organisms. In the world, the prebiotic world, which I cannot really describe, but I can say that it was RNA dominated. And RNA was doing all the functions that RNA needs. It can extend itself, it can copy itself, it can synthesize itself. So it did what it needed. It was working also as enzymes. Not very efficient enzymes, but enzymes that could do all what I said earlier. And this, in our opinion, a little machinery within this RNA well that was needed for the RNA needs is the seed around which life started. So there was RNA-dominated world, amino acids came in. Amino acids are very clever. And they conquered this machinery and taught it to make peptide bonds. It means to make small, very small proteins, oligopeptides. And these ones that could do jobs that the RNA well needed, like carrying metals or stabilizing the machinery that made them, these survived. These were fit, maybe not the strongest, but the best. And this gave rise to a primitive genetic code. And this primitive genetic code with these primitive proteins in the primitive RNA world evolved and optimized together. So this means that the genetic code came after its products. Once there was a little protein, a little oligopeptide that was needed, it created the genetic code. And this together with the ribosome or the proto-ribosome that also became optimized were the seeds around which life started. Thank you.
Thank you for your ideas on the RNA world and I think interesting idea that the genetic code came afterwards. Let's go on to...
One more word. Ribosome is very efficient. The RNA enzymes are very inefficient. And the efficiency of ribosomes is because they have not only RNA, but also proteins that help, which also strengthens the idea that genetic code and proteins were created after the RNA was already making small bones.
Okay, thank you. Let's go on with the chemistry, but perhaps a little broader, and Robert will talk to us about the role of chemistry in life.
Good morning, thank you.
I have to put it on.
Is it working now?
Yes.
Right, the motto we were given of the Asian Science Camp is, how can science improve the future of mankind? And you gave us several topics to choose. Now, you also said that we have to understand the presence, and in particular, the material basis to understand life. And this is my field of research. I focus on chemistry, and what I'm going to say is an address to chemistry and its role in the sciences. I recently attended a meeting in Spain similar to this, many young students, a meeting that was under the theme Science, the Motto of Economic Development. Now there is a clear relation between these two mottos, the future of mankind and economic development definitely closely related. It's also obvious that there is no development and sustainable growth without science. And it is also clear that science is executed by scientists. And if you look at science history, the many of the most important discoveries were made by young scientists, by you, or a few years later when you continue with your university studies. So, as I said, I would like to highlight the role of chemistry in almost all of the points that you gave us. When I studied chemistry in the 1950s, most of the tools we now do have available were not yet around, had not yet been discovered, but revolutionized the sciences and economy. So developments in chemistry, but also, of course, in physics and in biology. So what is chemistry? Chemistry is the science of matter, of atoms, of molecules, and their transformation. It may be regarded as an art when we look at the synthesis of very complex organic natural molecules. It is actually the oldest natural science when humans extracted pigments from minerals and from plants to paint bodies and clothes. And it is reflected by the fact that industrial organic chemistry was born in the second half of the 19th century making artificial pigments from coal and tar. Achievements in chemistry marked the major steps in cultural evolution of mankind. We speak of the Bronze Age, of the Iron Age, when men learned to make metals and alloys. Today, I would think we have the Plastic Age, when men learned to make polymers with very diverse properties. A fascinating development, new materials that we can make now. So chemistry, a decisive role in all natural sciences, even in astronomy, when the optical spectra of distant parts of in the universe are analyzed. Their analysis is based on the analysis of chemical molecules that occur on Earth. We know since the design of the periodic table by Mendeleev and Meyer, which I regard as one of the most important, if not the most important, discoveries in chemistry, that there are no other elements in the universe than those seen on Earth, and that has consequences. There is no other chemistry in the universe than the chemistry that we see on Earth, and of course, that has been explored extensively. We know that only carbon-based chemistry can make these very elaborate and complex molecules on which life depends. So the question of how will life look like if it exists on other planets, I would say it will look like we. Because of this fact that the chemistry is universal in the universe, in the universe, and because of the Darwinian laws, which are also universal. Now, the role in physics of chemistry, making the materials for transistors by controlled doping, their miniaturization, the making the perfect crystals for lasers, to name just a few of these chemical processes essential for physics. The material basis of communication revolution rests on chemistry. Then in biology, the giant steps in molecular biology by gene and protein analysis were made by discoveries of the chemistry of DNA and proteins, their transformations, and the discovery of specific chemical reactions for cleavage of this polymer step by step that led then to the analysis of the sequences of proteins and of DNA. Then chemistry for food production, so chemistry provides the fertilizers, the Haber-Bosch ammonia synthesis. So we would not be around here without the fertilizers made by the Haber-Bosch process. The Earth could not feed the population right now, not to speak of the projection of the population growth. Chemistry provides the pesticides to control the damage by wheat plants, by insects, by fungi, bacterial and viral pathogens. Chemistry provides the material for energy production, the solar cells. So chemistry for the huge challenges of mankind, that is food for a growing population, health and protection against continuously emerging bacterial and viral pathogens. Bacteria are extremely clever. We fight against them. We find a way to treat bacterial infections, but bacteria mutate. But we have the tools to fight these mutants as well. So energy, I mentioned, probably mainly solar. You heard Professor Lee's lecture, but every other relatively clean source must be used before we enter the solar age. This will take some time. So chemistry will play a decisive role in all developments by making drought and salt-tolerant croplands, together with biology and the analysis of physiological pathways. New strategies by analyzing the biology of pathogens and the design and chemical synthesis of novel antibiotics. New materials for solar cells, easier and cheaper to make. Now, food, energy, health, and environment are the huge challenges for mankind, but we have a solution. And chemistry contributes to the solutions. But of course, it lies in the brains of the young people. So my appeal is to treat them properly, give them the opportunity to carry out research as they wish to do. The future is with you. But I would like to add one more thing, the role of politicians in all of this. I grew up as a war child. Germany was in ruins when I began to enter school. There was no school, because also the school was in ruins. There was, of course, no science, no research at that time during wartime. So peace is the key, I think, to further development, quite essential. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Robert, for giving a broad overview of the role of chemistry. Perhaps we can move on to something about improving the future, and in particular, in promoting health of the people. And may I ask Professor Zuhausen to talk about preventive medicine.
Well, thank you very much, but kindly permit me to make a few words about the development of life, or at least of some sorts from my side, because clearly it's the most interesting question, how life originated on Earth, and I agree with Ada, it's irrespective whether it developed here on the Earth or whether it came from somewhere of the universe, but the most interesting aspect is really how could life develop? Is it, if we have life on other planets, would the life be have a similar basis than life here on Earth or not? In my opinion, it must not necessarily have a similar basis. It's probably likely to some degree similar, but not certainly not necessarily an identical mode. Even the genetic code might be somewhat different there than it is on Earth. They might use ribosomes as we do here, or they might not, that is really a question of which is quite important, which I do not believe. That is namely that if there exist creatures on other planets, that they would be similar to what we have here on Earth. Because life depends, wherever it exists, on environmental circumstances. And the evolution is determined to a large degree by the environment. So in that sense, it's highly unlikely that on another planet, the environment will be identical to the environment we have here. And for that reason, I would speculate, at least, that life will be different on other planets, if it exists at all. But that's all. Well, I'm a medically trained person myself, and I worked for my lifetime on cancer and the development of cancer, trying to identify cancer risk factors, and also to see to which extent by finding the cancer risk factors, we can do something to prevent disease, and specifically, of course, cancer in this case. And that is really something which is developing, in my opinion, reasonably well. We can identify a number of risk factors right now that doesn't only account for cancer, of course, it accounts for many other types of diseases, including neurological diseases, vascular diseases, and also to metabolic diseases as well. But as a matter of fact, due to the medical interventions, it became possible to extend the human lifespan to some degree. Probably not to such a degree as it was estimated in the past, but basically, let's say, if you would be able and if it would be possible to prevent cancer, or at least the most common forms of cancer globally, we probably could reduce or we could prolong the lifespan of individuals by about 2 or 3 years at most. But nevertheless, of course, there are many other reasons for disease. In these years right now, we experience that there are a couple of novel ways to prevent diseases, and coming from the cancer field, I think I'd better save it for the second part of the discussion round. We have indeed quite a number of modalities by which we can do something against those types of developments. So I think I will leave it at that at this stage, but I find the discussion about the origins of life quite fascinating.
Okay, thank you very much for your ideas and origin and life and medicine. Professor Lee, would you like to say a few words and on this, whatever your comments on others, other talks to others?
You know, I'm always very worried if I sit next to a medical doctor or people working on medicine when they say, I'm pro-life, want to extend the life expectancy, then I already think, well, I work so hard and sometime in my life, I would like to go. to give the chance to the young generation rather than prolong my life. Of course, I like to be like my friend. He lived until 7 years and suddenly he disappeared. And so we will not be the burden for the next generation. Because I saw my mother when she was 88, she told me that, Yuan, I have a good life. I'm ready to go. It's a terminal cancer. And she said, I do not like to suffer like others being treated and treated and treated. But when she was in the hospital, that was a long time ago, medical doctor said, our responsibility is to keep your mother alive. So she did suffer. Also, I said, my mother told me that she is ready to go, do not want to suffer. But my young sister's brothers want to keep her. So at the end, she really suffered. So I'm a little worried that I will not want to keep her.
Permit me a quick response. I would be totally misunderstood if I would have intended to advocate really a long prolongation of life. But what we do as physicians and what is our duty, in fact, is to relieve the suffering which occurs due to diseases, and that's clearly what is intention. But on the other hand, we must say at the same time, it's indeed prolonging the life, and that relates to some of the problems which you mentioned this morning.
Well, my area of science is really trying to understand chemistry from the law of mechanics. So when I started to do experiment, I did a lot of scaling, all the trajectories, and try to understand interatomic forces from differential crossation, so one can understand all the transport phenomena or chemical reactions based on quantum mechanics. And it is amazing to see over the years, I believe in around 1980, scientists said, Professor Lee, you're doing some chemical reaction in a very detailed way, like fluorine plus deuterium molecule, how the energy distribution looks like. And when you don't have to do experiment and theoretical calculation will reveal all you have been doing. I said, maybe turn of the century. And lots of theorists look at me and say, Professor Lee, turn of the century is a long, long time. I'm talking about 20 years. Turn of the century came. It's indeed, one can do quantum calculation to do all the things we've been doing. So we do not need to do experiment of the simple system. We could understand alignment of the molecule, how chemical reaction takes place. But the amazing thing is, I'm serving as advisory board member at the Lawrence Berkeley Laboratory. And during the previous meeting, Lawrence Berkeley Laboratory is setting up the computation center. And they want to solve many problems, like energy problems, so they're developing batteries. So battery, all done by theoretical calculation, start with 3,000 compound, multivalent, So not just using lithium, multivalent structure will not change. Also doing some catalysis, photosensitized catalysis. And all those are done by theoretical calculation, put thousands of molecules and then pick up some candidates, so maybe 10 molecules, then started to do experiment. The amazing thing was the energy they are using for theoretical calculation, the computer center they are setting up will use up about the same amount of energy Lawrence Berkeley Laboratory has been using, including the synchrotron light source and other experimental facilities. The time has changed. When we were young, if university didn't have enough money, say, hire theorists. Theorists would not do experiments, so you can save lots of money, except astronomy. Astronomy costs lots of money. So in chemistry department, they say, hire theorists. Now, in the Lawrence Berkeley Laboratory, so they say, find experimentalists. Theorists cost lots of money. Just using computer center takes half the money. But things has changed drastically. So I'm hoping that the one day when I was in ribosome and RNA, and when those are started, I just thought half a century ago, a scientist from Sri Lanka, the name is called Pelamparuma, he was looking at the like thunder create some nitrogen containing compound. People are looking at the why phosphor is the element God has chosen to be the elements of life. But anyway, we still do not know the mystery of how life originated. I only know my mother and my father fell in love, so they bring my life on earth. And that's part I know. Other part, okay. I'm not sure.
Thank you very much for your ideas. I think the idea of whether we want to keep on living forever is an interesting thing to think about. Anyway, I think all of our panelists have given their ideas. So it's now time to give the opportunity for students to ask questions. Anyone want to ask questions? We have some questions here, but do you want to select some questions and then...
Your abstract one, this question was asked by the student called BO15. Professor Arthur Yunus is expiring as the first Middle Eastern woman and the first woman in 45 years to be awarded the Nobel Prize in Chemistry. To all the panelists, but specifically to Professor Yunus, what advice do you have for young women in science? And to Professor Yunus, what obstacle did you have to face and overcome in your years as a prominent scientist?
You really want me to answer?
Well, the
answer this question as origin of life or? Well, I'll answer it very quickly. I don't see myself as a woman scientist, but as a scientist. The fact that I was born a woman... The fact that I was born a woman is clear. I cannot change it, and I don't want to change it. I enjoyed it very much. We, the women, have some privileges that they don't have. They cannot become pregnant. They cannot deliver children. They cannot enjoy this. We can. So instead of looking at it as obstacles or as punishment, we should enjoy it and enjoy science at the same time. Science is not easy. Science is demanding for female and for male. You can ask them. But I don't see any difference by the demand. Maybe it's a bit more tricky to continue science and continue family. But if young girls, if you love both and you're really curious and you have passion to science and love to your family, you will make it. nothing special about being a woman, except our privilege to be also mothers. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think it'd be good if we get the questions from the audience. We have a whole batch of questions here. So anybody who has sent a question here, can raise your hands and ask in person. Yeah? Okay, you. That's in the red.
My question is, if life has originated on Earth and it has not been inherited from anywhere else in the universe, we must observe that the life has originated within 1.5 billion years of Earth's creation, but it has taken a much longer time, around 2.5 billion years, to evolve from single cellular to multicellular. So is it reasonable that creation of life takes place sooner than evolution of life?
What did you really ask? No.
No, I asked that.
Can you just say the question? Not the speculation around it.
The creation of life is a very complex process. It should take longer time. When life is already created, it is perhaps easier to evolve. But we see that it has taken a shorter time for the creation of life. So doesn't it indicate that life has been originated from somewhere else?
What is longer and shorter?
Life has created.
You say longer time, shorter time. What do you mean by
comparatively,
this?
life has created on Earth within 1.5 billion years of Earth's creation.
How do you know this? Well, if he asks, we want to understand what is the question.
That is the earliest life form, the proof of earliest life form we have got on Earth.
I think if I understand your question, you wanted to ask whether life is a creation, which is not really something which can be assessed by scientific means, or whether it can be assessed scientifically. Yeah. And let me respond in my way. I clearly think it can be assessed scientifically, because first of all, we can even today, as a virologist, what I am, we can even today create viruses according to the plan of the nucleic acids which exist in them, and we can then create as infectious agents for humans as well. So that is one possibility. There are other possibilities to transfer the, or to create completely anew the DNA of a bacterium, a small, tiny bacterium, and to transfer it into the plasma of another bacterium and to create, so to speak, a different species of bacteria under those circumstances. It's not yet possible to create a living cell at this stage, but at least many people, including myself, believe that it will be possible in the future.
Yeah, but that's what I am saying. It is more difficult to create life, but when it is created, once it is created, a living cell, it can divide and become multicellular. But creation of life has, according to the proof we have got, creation of life has taken place within 1.5 billion years, but it has evolved over a time period of 2.5 billion years. So why has such longer time taken to for the evolution of life?
Okay.
Well,
just going to move on.
I would say that we really do not know the exact answer yet, but I said the computation simulation is improving so much. Some mathematicians sitting here, I do believe the origin of life I think lots of light will be shed through the fundamental calculation and simulation of the system that we do not know. Maybe soon in the future, we can have some model how life is created by mathematicians sitting here.
So, yes, Robert.
Now, we know that there are quite complex organic molecules in the universe, but there is a big gap of knowledge from that stage, so small organic molecules, to larger molecules that are self-reproducible. So we don't know how that happened. If you call this creation, it's fine with me, but it's just not known. Now, once you have self-reproducible biological molecules, there are the rules and the law of Darwin, and we understand it very well.
Okay, let's move on. I have a question here, Professor Murayama. How do you define vacuum? Is it a matter or energy? If matter, what is it made of?
Okay, so the definition of the word vacuum in physics is very clear. That is the lowest energy condition, and that's the definition. And the word vacuum doesn't say anything about if there's anything in there or not. And we believe it's actually stuffed with lots of things in there. I'm not sure that answers the question. Does it?
This one. The solution of preventing doomsday from coming fast is to decrease global temperature as soon as possible. If we keep the world in perfect stable temperature for living things, still doomsdays will come. Talking about financial. Should the world spend $100 billion per year for cosmology rather than developing all developing countries by 2020? Well, a lot of you can have your ideas on that. Would you like $100 billion, Professor Murayama?
I should defend Dr. Murayama. As I say, $100 billion is really a small amount of money. I would challenge the defense budget we are spending, that's trillions of dollars. So if we become peaceful, there's no war, then all the money, you can have lots of small cosmology, those astronomical experiments, and you can stop the deforestation, and we can do a lot of things. And if young people all agree this, we eliminate the national boundary, there's no war, no more war, or fix the national boundary, there will be no war, and defense budget, trillions of dollars, or transfer it to the scientific research, then we find we have lots of money, so you don't have to worry about couldn't find a job or research proposal will not be funded.
Do you want me to say anything?
Well, I certainly agree that $100 billion is really a small amount of money compared to what world consumes in many different ways. I don't know what else I can say. So certainly the peaceful, developing peaceful application of science, developing scientific methodology, and doing research in many different ways is really the way of, I hope, that drive the human race forward. And so I completely agree with Professor Lee on that.
So the year 2020 was mentioned here. I think in relation to reach peace all over the world, maybe I add another duty for 2020, which was actually announced by the American pharma companies, is a new antibiotic, at least one, that can resist resistance. maybe this will also work in our profit.
I mean, I come back to this question, how to spend money. Should we spend money? I mean, money can't be spent only once. So should we spend it to send a huge telescope? Or should we spend it in medical research or biological research? Money can be spent only once. So this is a political decision that has to be made, no doubt, which we can influence in ways by discussing our science, the results of our research, astronomical research or medical research, and try to convince the public and the politicians in what direction money should be spent. Now, there are sometimes quite unusual effects, and in one I was involved. Now, the physicists built these large synchrotrons for their purposes to study the forces that hold atoms together. Now we found then in the 50s that during the operation of these synchrotrons, powerful X-rays are generated, and we thought, or the crystallographic community thought that this could be used for our purposes as strong X-ray sources. Now, we were allowed to use the synchrotrons as in the parasitic time. So we were regarded as parasites to come when the physicists had lunch or dinner or during the night time. So sometimes quite unexpected phenomena appeared in a field that was quite different from our own research interest, but with enormous consequences for my own research, which is in X-ray crystallography. So we use the machines that the physicists have built and developed and the engineers.
Okay, I think time is running out, but let me have another couple of questions. I think this one from Professor Wawowski. If we are, can be, second or third generation of organic life on the Earth and even on the universe, do you think there will be someone or something after us?
Yes.
I'm afraid the question goes on and says, can your opinion be explained with reference to science, biology, chemistry, physics, or math? It's not. he doesn't want yes. No, that's okay. Let's.
Well. It can be probably explained with reference to the history of life on Earth as we know it, and to the to what we know about the geological and astronomical timescales, and clearly the phenomenon of humanity is something which has been existing on an extremely short interval of geological time on Earth. And Earth is not going anywhere. It's going to to exist for many more, well, at least tens of millions of years at least, because as we discussed, we don't know what's going to happen to our solar system in 25 million years. But from the point of view of the star, for billions of years, and the universe is going to exist for hundreds or thousands of billions of years, we have no idea. So from this perspective, it's very hard to imagine us as we are to exist for such a long period of time. I mean, just as an individual human being dies and then has children, so probably a species dies and has something like children. And so we probably should be thinking also about our kind of children as a species, not right away, not right now, because we're very young, and I don't think we're going to die anytime soon. But I don't see us as living for the duration of the life of the universe or the galaxy.
Could I say something? Yeah. I think when dinosaurs disappeared from the surface of the Earth, where were our ancestors? At that time, our ancestor is very small, might be just like a small rat, and evolved, and take a long time and become like we are today. It takes a long, long time. And if we change the Earth system into a different state, all ice melted and ocean rises, radioactivity changes, and there's some kind of singular event then wipe us out, then something which survive will start to evolve. It takes long, long time. So we are not destroying the Earth system, we are changing the Earth system. Humanity is the one which might disappear, and that might disappear very soon if we do not change things sooner than what we look at things in astronomical time, because like dinosaur disappeared, it took a very short time. When meteorite hit, cool down, dinosaur disappears. But don't worry, something will survive. Earth will be in different state, and evolution of life might take different form. So future inhabitant of the Earth might not look like us, might be entirely different.
Okay. May I just say one word, that we can also still be alive while our children are already alive, which happens to human beings quite often, fortunately. So it might be that there will already be something which will come after us while we still be here. Who knows? I mean, I'm thinking in much longer timescales, and I agree with you that if we really screw up now and this kind of burst of civilization dies out, then we'll fail Earth, because we have consumed the natural resources, we have consumed the kind of the capital which was accumulated by Earth over hundreds of millions of years, and to start anew would be very difficult. So that I agree with you with, but I think we won't fail, and I think we will pass this hurdle. But then, what will happen then?
Well, I guess human life can be extinguished in 100, 1,000 or less years. That's quite open at this moment. But if a cosmic catastrophe occurs, which has been predicted at least to occur in some million years from now or so, a sun explosion, probably all life will be extinguished here, which exists on Earth right now. There might be a new step for a new evolution somewhere else. But clearly, this would be the end of life here.
I think this one should be for Professor Murayama. I have a question about scientist's job. I once heard that there are too many cosmologists and lack of place to work in the world. Is there a specific reason that caused this situation? And do the world really need a science developing?
That's an interesting question. What is the right size of the number of scientists in individual disciplines? My fellow cosmologist, Rocky Cole from University of Chicago, argued science budget has to be allocated according to the fraction of the universe. So dark energy gets the most, dark matter next, and then chemistry gets 10 to minus 5, biology, I don't know. But clearly that's a wrong argument, because we do science partly because of the impact we have on society, and also the level of curiosity people have in these different scientific disciplines. So that's a very difficult thing to answer. And one of you mentioned, I forgot who that was, that this is ultimately a political decision to some extent, how much should be spent on which disciplines, and I don't know the right answer to that question. So in particular in the case of cosmology, astronomy, particle physics, we are always called useless science, so we shouldn't get much share of the taxpayers' money. And there's some merit to that argument, I have to agree to it. At the same time, as Professor Lee also said, and also the synchrotron is an example, a lot of technologies that have been developed in this sort of useless science had been actually quite useful in other areas as well. So it's very difficult to gauge what is the right balance. So it's true, in the case of cosmology, astrophysics, particle physics, job situation can be tight, simply because there are not large number of jobs in the world. But at the same time, I should also mention, people who are trained in this field have been also very successful in moving into other disciplines, while also in the industry, because they were trained well in quantitative thinking, problem solving, and addressing really sort of mysterious subjects which people haven't thought about before. So that kind of way of making your brain flexible, I believe, will be useful anywhere you go.
Murayama-san said it's a political decision to decide how much money you spend on the astronomy or cosmology. But actually, I will tell you one observation. Politicians do not see things eye to eye, they always have different views. But if you take politician to the mountain and let them use telescope, look at the star far, far away, then everybody will have a parallel vision, and you will see that the conflict will reduce immediately when you look at the things far, far away. It is parallel. So it's not a political decision how much you spend in the astronomy. I think it's our responsibility to take the politician to look at the telescope and look at things far, far away.
About a question about ethics. How far, if at all, should we let ethics and morals limit the research? Valuable information can be ignored in the past due to the nature that it has been attained. Should we continue to let ethics limit us and our research, or free ourselves at the cost that may not be worth it? Should ethics, what is the role of ethics in science, please?
So I just want to, there can be different kind of meaning, understandings of this question. One thing which we should be very, very, we in the first place, and then you, as a growing generation, should be extremely intent on, is on keeping a high level of ethics among ourselves. So we should always be worried and should take care to make sure that we, as a scientists, are behaving ethically according to our standards of ethics of our society of scientists. I mean behaving ethically with respect to each other. I'm not talking at this point with respect to human subjects, but I'm talking with respect to graduate students and postdocs and colleagues. And very importantly, also those who were before us and who are not with us anymore. So those whom we cite, whose work we use, and so on. So this kind of ethics is paramount for keeping the science as a human enterprise healthy, I think. But there is this other kind of ethics, and that's where I would defer to people who are doing more of a human kind of science in terms of whether it's ethical to do various kinds of genetic manipulations and stuff like this. This is a different sort of question.
Would Professor Zuhausen or Ada comment on the biological and what medical aspects?
At least you can look at from two different viewpoints at this question. First of all, ethics and science, of course, it's simply answered one question. One answer would be avoid fraud. That is clearly most important because it clearly exists in science as well. But on the other hand, of course, ethics, as far as specific developments which are risky for the future development of mankind are concerned, of course, these are important questions. The example of the atomic bomb development clearly demonstrated what devastating consequences science can have under certain circumstances, particularly in war times. I mean, as far as gene technology is concerned, of course, there have been enormous amounts of questions in the past concerning the application of specific techniques in the development of embryonic cells, the repair of non-functioning genes and so on. These are difficult questions which need to be evaluated in each case quite individually. And let me say one word which may not sound very popular, but the view of ethics occasionally are changing to some degree in the human societies. And you can easily see it in a reproductive medicine where a few aspects became very well accepted by now, which in the past were almost impossible to visualize.
Yes.
So in a few words, ethics is ethics is ethics everywhere. In science and in every other aspect of our life, we have to keep to ethics. It's true that ethics values and the way to judge ethics is changing together with the evolution of knowledge and of people, as we just heard. When we didn't know much about something, we could easily kill it with not being ethical. We could also go into it and learn it and then find out that it can be used ethical. But because there are some scientists or some people that are not ethical in their life, it doesn't say that all the human beings or all the scientists are not ethical. In my opinion, most, if not all, of the science being carried out today is based on ethical values, an ethical basis. And in this case, I will not say it. But maybe yes. You thought that if you show a politician a big telescope, it changes his mind? All politicians have been in hospitals, or at least their families were. You think that they are supporting medical science more because of it? Thank you.
Well, I want to mention that when Madame Curie was doing science, people always ask, why didn't you apply for patent? If you apply for patent, the way you separate the radium polonium, you'll be as rich as Edison. And Madame Curie always said, scientific knowledge accumulated by scientists should belong to all human beings. I was inspired by her idealism. Of course, nowadays, it's very different. You invent something, you apply for the patent, you might try hard, the patent will not be abused, so will be widely available. And during the last couple of days, I've been receiving an email from Jeffrey Sachs in Columbia University. He's the chairman of Sustainable Development Solution Network, but his email content is not about sustainable development. He analyzed the medicine used for hepatitis C, a company who didn't really did the research, bought some patent, and then in the market, they are reaping the profit of thousands of times and very expensive. That medicine should become available at a very low price. But so he was analyzing where the money putting in, how come such an unethical company which makes such a big profit. And that is one of the problems people are talking about. Many young people doing biological studies will dream that they will come up with a medicine, will become a billionaire one day when the medicine is developed. So those are the kind of things which we really need to examine.
Well, as you mentioned, patenting. I think without patenting, there would be no chemical industry, yeah. There would be no pharma industry. So there is some quite high value in that, because chemical research, pharma research is costly and has to be, money has to be earned. I would like to add some word to the ethics problem that had been addressed by Harold and by Ada, and also say that there are variable and changing views on what is ethical. And let me explain that with one example. So we are presently discussing the GMO plant situation in Europe. In most of the European countries, GMO plants are not allowed to the farmers. On the other hand, it's quite clear that the yield with these GMO plants is quite higher, or there are additional benefits. Think of the yellow rice that provides vitamin A, which can, as I heard, not be planted in Thailand. So is this ethical? Now, people say to change the genome of a wild-type plant is non-ethical. This is one view. On the other hand, a higher yield of a crop plant to get there, to feed more people, a safer plant, that would be very ethical, I would think. So there is the problem of defining ethics in many cases.
Just a short.
That's a very brief comment. I believe that patents are necessary in some instances, because otherwise we would avoid the development of specific types of medicines. The question of the pricing policy of some of the companies, that's a different issue. And I agree with you fully, there are some unethical aspects in it as well.
Of course, ethics is a very difficult question, because not only that, it also depends on which side you are on the problems, and also the ethics can also change. And the one thing I was very surprised when I moved to Berkeley, going to the library there, was that there are many documents about developing nuclear weapons. Robert Oppenheimer was a theoretical physicist at Berkeley who led the Manhattan Project that produced nuclear weapons that was dropped in my home country and killed 100,000 people. Now, was that the right thing or not? And in the US, it is thought that was the only possible thing to save Japan. In Japan, it's thought a completely opposite way. Who is right? I don't know. And the reason they developed nuclear weapons is partly because they wanted to avoid Nazis to destroy the world. So they were actually driven by ethical needs to develop nuclear weapons. So ethics is very difficult to define because it depends on which side you are. And that also applies not to physicists and you know, not just us to be blamed, but also chemical weapons and biological weapons. Mathematicians are also not immune either. Alan Turing actually deciphered Enigma of German military, which of course saved many British lives, which in turn of course destroyed many German lives. So ethics are very difficult to define, and I am not giving any answers, just throwing another issue we have to grapple with.
We've gone a little bit over time, but I wanted to ask this last question. I think it's very important. The issues of environmental sustainability that the Professor Lee mentioned today are all highly related to science, economy, and the society, and they have to draw the public's attention. What can we, as the future scientists, do to help educate the public about these issues, and how can we change the harsh situation now? So I think you will start off, and if anybody would like to comment.
I would say that the actually question and answer session, we should divide it into two. The first for students to ask us, then for us to ask students. And when I'm a student, I always find that if I were to be in the opposite position, student will learn more. So that's the question, actually, I would like to ask students and say, listen to my lecture. You should come up with some idea. How can you communicate with the public, with your friend, with your parent, and try to convince them what's happening, what could be done? Don't ask me to answer that question. It's my position to ask you the question. So everybody got a question now.
All right, it's your future, right?
Right.
It's your future. So what are you going to do about it? Anyone want to make a commitment?
Right. Maybe somebody could answer it. Raise your hand.
Yes, please.
I'd like to answer this question. I'd like to introduce myself. I'm Anton from Team India. The question that has been posed is really quite a complicated one, but I'd like to answer it in the perspective that I have achieved over the years of 20 that I have lived. The point is that as history guides, there are two methods of really imbibing something into humans. One is through fear, the other is through wisdom. That is my opinion. If we target the current generation, the generation that is growing up, through the education means that we usually provide them, including mass media, the social environment that they live in, the upbringing of theirs, it all affects their lives. So if we imbibe this culture, this idea into all these facets through which they acquire knowledge, they acquire information, they acquire this thinking, or the thinking is made, then we would be able to achieve the very goal that we want. I mean that everything should start from the very basic level. After having achieved a particular stage in life, it is very difficult to convince. We can rather confuse people, but not convince them, because there are already something in our minds that has been fixed because the way we have lived life. So I think that we can achieve the very goal that we want of really, if I've understood the question properly, to really join and collaborate everyone into the goal of making a scientific living and not a living based on selfish needs. Thank you.
Anyone else want to make a comment?
Well, I'm a student from China, and I want to say something about this question. I think the main problem for this question is that there is one thing that confuses people, which is selfishness. We just think, consider something about ourselves, and like Professor Lee just said in the plenary, some countries are overdeveloped and people there enjoy their lives, but they don't consider others' feelings. I think we should have some thoughts through this, and I think globalization is very important. We should think about others, but not just ourselves. And just like why we devote ourselves to science, because we want the world to be better. Yes, that's my opinion. Thank you.
Okay. Yes. Yeah.
Hello, my name is Nick from Thailand. I would like to add on to a bit to the problem and what the other two said is like, we talk about people being selfish and trying to think of themselves, but I think that one of the problem is we already created a culture of having, trying to fulfill our needs. And another big problem is that the people who are the teachers themselves, the people who are the parents, are the ones who also teach this and build into the students on having this bad habit. And also the part of having politicians and trying to solve the problem. Well, a lot of politicians are voted by the poor people who, in their perspective, they have, I mean, they do not have, in some cases, they do not have the basic needs. Therefore, why would they care about what would happen in the near future? So I think that one of the things that we should do is, firstly, is to create a new culture of having sustainability. And secondly, is some way that we can weave in sustainability into our economic process. As what you might said, using carbon taxes, or what I've read other than that, or carbon credit, or giving subsidies to products. So when people think about to purchase something, you tend to think more, is this environmentally friendly? Because it directly affects what is the cost and something that you have to pay. And I think this is my opinion of how are we going to solve the problem.
So I think we, there's two more questions. Okay. Just last two questions, last two comments.
Thank you. Hi, I'm a student from China. I think because of the diversity of what inside humans' heart, I think it's really hard to just advocate some kind of culture or advocate that we should take care of others. I think that the climate stuff is an urgent issue, and we can't just add some culture and tell somebody to do it, and it will not work for everyone. I think we can make full use of the common emotion we share as human beings, like fear or honor. I think we can use the numbers, the phenomena to show them the consequence of the use, the overuse of the resources, and then tell them that if our human being want to continue our honor, continue our achievements, we should avoid these kind of things, and we should advocate a pathway to the future, to the future of honor. And that's what I want to say. Thanks.
Thank you. Last comment. No. One, just last comment. The lady there. Yeah. Sorry, we have to end this shortly.
Morning. I would like to add on to the comments expressed by the previous participants. Actually, studying in science, but I'm also very interested in social sciences. Actually, often we talk too much about science and we neglected a lot of the human elements within our discussion. So actually, what I think of is during the summit meetings or discussion among panelists or politicians, I think it is a good idea to bring in social scientists such as social psychologists, because they are the one studying a lot about the social phenomenon, that they will know the way of how to influence people in a mass scale. So, for example, education, and also to propagate some ideas, and also to promote sustainability. I think social psychology is a very important element in transforming the society. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Well, perhaps we end with some last comments from the panelists. Would you like to make just a few comments or last closing remarks from anybody? Each speaker.
Yeah, I don't think this is a closing remark, but I would say when I gave the presentation and said what would be happening, very often it's based on the assumption that human society is still going the way it has been. But when we talk about change, you are the ones who could initiate very different change, as I suggested. And so you have to look at all the things I said or other people said very critically, and you communicate with each other and find a better way. As a scientist, we always think about, is there a better way to do things? And when I give the presentation, I do not feel comfortable about the future, and I know there must be a better way of doing things. Like the lady said, we might learn to shrink and share, and there are many concepts we might have to introduce for the change. And I don't think I will give you the answer. Many of the suggestions you are making, you should integrate and find a new way. And then we will have better hope. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else? Thank you. Robert.
Well, we heard about the huge challenges and the dangers, growing population, destruction of the environment. But I'm also strongly convinced that we have the tools to solve these problems, and we do have the young brains to solve these problems if they are properly educated and properly treated. So this is on us to educate the young people, but I'm very, very optimistic that we can have a happy life on Earth also for the future generations.
Any more comment? Well, if there are no more comments, I'd like to thank the panelists for joining in this discussion and sharing their ideas, and thank you all for listening, and please take action as well as listen, and go back and try to do your best to make this world more sustainable. Thank you all.